Good morning. Welcome to Washington Park United Church of Christ. I'm Lee Berg, and I serve as pastor here at Wash Park. It is a joy to have you with us today. It's a special day with Ginny Swenson, our guest speaker, and Tom will introduce her in a little while. I'm told that Ginny and Colleen and Joan were all friends going back to when they were 15, which was a year or two ago. So anyway, it's a great day. Yesterday we had a wonderful retreat down at La Forêt. It was Wash Park Day at La Forêt, and going back to when the Utes occupied that area, it has always had a sense of sacredness about it, a place that is holy. I was telling the retreaters yesterday that in a conversation with a friend who serves on the board of Archway, who is Native American, that we have a lot to learn from our understanding that the divine shows up in every part of creation. And she said, I'm doing some work on the strength and the power of old forests and the lessons that can be learned from old forests. La Forêt sits in the middle of an old forest. And the area that does not have trees did at one time. It is beautiful. Old forests provide sustenance to all trees in the forest, not just the species of the majority of the trees. Lessons to be learned. So as we begin our service, I would invite you to take a moment to breathe, to pray, to open yourself to the Spirit, to open yourself to all that is holy, to open yourself to being in community with one another. May we pray and breathe. In these uncertain times where anxiety runs high, where heartache and pain do not take a vacation, we pray that we will, in these moments, experience sanctuary and a sense of peace. We pray for those who are facing war, brutality, the loss of innocent lives, the loss of all lives. We pray that we would be instruments of peace in our spheres of influence, in our communities, and beyond. Thank you for your grace that sustains us and enables us to live in these times with strength, with understanding, and with hope. For it's in the name of the one who is divine that we pray. Amen. To our guests, because of who you are and because of where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here.
I'm Barb Allen, and I'd like you to join me in a responsive call to celebration. The simple wooden bowl sat solitary in a mountain town art museum. The artist had carved it from beetle kill pine. Don't you love how people keep striving for transformation? And how God makes us a way of no way? And how God can maybe, just maybe, take a beetle kill people, community, nation, hallowed out, left for dead, and proclaim something new? Isn't that something worth getting out of bed for in the morning? Isn't that something worth working for? Isn't that something worth our time and efforts and soulful struggles? And what marvels of love and justice, joy and community might we then hold? If you're able, please stand and join us for singing our opening song, Love and Justice.
I'm introducing Ginny this morning. And Lee mentioned that Ginny and Colleen and Joan, who's here this morning, all went to Cherry Creek High School back in the, I don't know, early 2000s. But Ginny didn't know Colleen until they met in hospice, and they figured out they were in the same class the same year amongst the thousands of high schoolers at Cherry Creek. So they built a relationship and we became friends. And Ginny is both a very good person and a very smart person, and that's why we invited her today. Her background, both in hospice and in teaching at Regis University and Community College of Denver. She's taught a lot about death and dying. Not that any of us are looking toward that, but it's something that I think maybe we think about others doing that. So we're really pleased and honored to have Ginny with us this morning. And you can give her a round of applause.
Okay, so can you hear me? Yes? Okay. I've never worn one of these things, so I'll try to leave it alone. Thank you, Tom, and thank you for inviting me to come speak. And yeah, I'm just going to speak just a little bit today about kind of coping with grief and the grief in our world. And I think that all of us are certainly aware that I think we're experiencing so many feelings of loss due to all the changes happening in our world. And just kind of living in the midst of so many losses. And I mean, when I think about loss and change, I mean, it's, while we have climate change and we have gun violence and we have mental health issues and we have homelessness and we have divisiveness and war and all these things that I think quickly feel pretty overwhelming to all of us. And I think all these losses really, not only are they overwhelming, but it's really, for me, and what I hear around me is that it's just really challenging for all of us to find out how to walk in this world right now. And so I think because of all the change, and with change and with loss comes grief, and living in this time right now, it just feels to me like most of us are very, we're stirred, you know? I think things are just feeling so incredibly unsettled. And it's so easy during these times to feel alone. And I have a small private practice, and I work with people primarily around grief and transition. And I had a youngish client recently, youngish, like I think he's 40, but a young person to me. And he was just sharing to me how it's like he came to me around specific loss of, he lost both of his parents and a best friend, but it's like then after that he says, oh, I'm not ready to quit, because he says, I'm finding it's just so hard to know, what he was saying is, it's so hard to know how to be in this world right now. There's so much that just feels so, so challenging. And he said to me, he said, I'm not feeling lonely, but I'm feeling profoundly alone. And that really struck me on such a deep level, because I think that all of us have relationships and people that we care about, and I think that that helps us at least not feel quite so much loneliness. But I do wonder, you know, how much do we all feel alone? That feels different to me, you know? And I think alone in carrying this burden of what's happening in the world around us, and alone in carrying the weight of grief. And I think the reason there's so much aloneness is that I really don't think that we know how to talk about that and how to share that with one another. So I'm going to talk some about resilience and coping, but I thought it'd be nice to just start with a moment of reflection. And so what I'm going to ask or invite you all to do is to just think a little bit about what is unsettling for you right now in the current world at this moment? And I'm going to invite you just to close your eyes, to take a few minutes, and to reflect on what is most troubling to you, and to ask yourself, you know, how are you coping with it? How are you managing the stress? And as you reflect, maybe think a little bit about, you know, whether or not you really feel like you have support, you know, or if you're really feeling it alone. So I'm just going to ask for you to close your eyes, sort of reflect, get in touch with something that is really touching your heart, that's maybe unsettling or troubling, and we'll just have a few moments of silence. All right, I'll have you kind of come back. I wish we were sort of in a setting where it'd be a little bit easier maybe to do some sharing around that, but I just thought, I think not only are we kind of living in times that are so overwhelming with so much change, we're also living in a time where everything is so incredibly sped up, or at least that's what it feels like to me. And so I think Sometimes I don't even think we really know what's kind of laying heavy on our hearts or what grief we are actually feeling about all the issues that are going on in this world. So I think it's good to take a little time, reflect on that. And so I guess I want to say, too, that it's like, you know, I think that, you know, kind of when I think about so much of the grief in the world right now and how it's related to so many different social justice issues, and I feel like, yeah, there's just so many that are calling our attention to them. Sometimes I feel like they're actually even screaming at us. There's just so much. But today it's like I'm not talking, you know, I think we all need to find our way to attend to issues that are most important to us in terms of doing something in an active way. Because I think that's, we all need to be part of that. But today kind of my focus is much more on ourselves, you know, and kind of how can we strengthen our resilience, and also, and even kind of thinking about our coping ability. It's like, I mean, I might not be right about this, but it's what I'm hearing more is that I'm feeling like ways that we've coped in the past are not working so well, and so it seems like we need to develop new coping mechanisms. And I don't think any of us alone have those answers, but I think it's time to begin to think some about that and kind of help one another with that. So I'm going to kind of throw out a few things when I think about coping and resilience. And first, I'm just going to identify four qualities or disciplines that I think are needed collectively for us to practice during this time. And this might resonate with you and maybe not, but I'm just going to put them out there. And these were developed by a man who wrote a book called Choosing Earth, which is really about climate change and just kind of dealing with the world that we're living in right now. And so qualities and disciplines that we need to collectively practice, he identified these four. The first one is restraint. And I think restraint is kind of an interesting word, that we need to really practice restraint. And what I see with restraint is that it's like restraint offers us a breath, a time to pause, a moment of reflection to allow whatever needs to surface to come to the surface. And then a second quality that we all need to practice, in his view, is humility. And I think, again, we live in this time where I just feel like, well, I mean, we can all kind of identify, I think, as humans, we sort of feel like we really are the superior living beings in the world and rather entitled about that. But I think humility, it's so important. It kind of honors our mutuality, and it brings us to the, it allows us to feel interrelated with all other living beings. Then a third quality he talks about practicing is that of not knowing, you know, and that we truly do. I mean, life is a mystery, you know, and I think, again, kind of as humans, we want so much to have answers and we want to have solutions and we want to take on problems, but it's like there is so much that we really don't know. And if we really practice and embrace that, I think that's a piece of what helps us open up. And then a final quality he talks about in terms of the need for all of us to be aware of is that of letting go. And I think that's kind of what change calls upon us to do, is to let go. And I can speak for myself, letting go is not always a very easy practice at all. It's like I like to cling on to things that is like either that I know or that bring me comfort or that I care about. But I think we're at a time where, yeah, we too need to kind of practice a letting go so that, again, so it's like we can kind of truly be open to possible solutions or what will possibly come. So, I find those kind of interesting practices and kind of useful. That's why I wanted to share them today. And then I also wanted to share, I'm going to share a little bit about some specific things around resilience. But first, I wanted, I'm going to throw out another four ways that we can really tend our souls during times of grief. And I think, and I don't think that we do all of this very, very well either. So I think the first thing, you know, to really, when we're grieving and we're overwhelmed and things are difficult, I think that to really tend to our hearts and souls, it takes, we need to really practice self-compassion. And I think, you know, many of us that are so involved with, you know, trying to make the world better for others or having compassion for others, it's like, ooh, are we really compassionate to self? I don't know that we are. And so I think that it's so important to practice self-compassion. I think that this is a time when we really need to, I guess I'd say, turn to our feelings. You know, because I think that it's like, you know, again, I think, you know, we have all these amazing human traits, and some of them very good and some of them not particularly helpful. But I think, you know, we're really good at feeling all the positive emotions. But I think when it comes to the hard stuff, you know, anger, rage, sadness, grief, you know, it's like, yeah, we just want to keep them at arm's length. We just want them to go away. And I think we really need to turn to our feelings right now. Get through this, what we're facing. Another thing that I feel tends to all of us, and maybe in many different ways, but it's, I think it's also being honoring and being open to the beauty in our world. Because I think that beauty has an ability to nurture us like nothing else can. And I think that we need to welcome that and bring that, find ways of bringing that into our lives right now with so much that's difficult coping with. And then kind of the final one, tending to ourselves, is just kind of, it goes along with self-compassion, but it's just also kind of a patience, being patient. And, you know, like when I talked about restraint earlier, you know, I feel like, I think what gets us so much into trouble is, and it's certainly happening more and more, how we're becoming so incredibly reactive. You know, so it's sort of like, you know, something appears in front of us and it's like we are immediately responding, you know, with an opinion or a solution or whatever that is. And it's like, yeah, we need to kind of hold back a little bit and have a little patience with ourselves and one another. But then, you know, in talking about, you know, I do think that it is so important for us right now to find ways of being resilient, because I think, you know, I think we often live with holding this continuum of, or the continuum, the way that I see it is it's kind of like hope is on one end and then despair is on another. And I think that what's happening for many of us by everything going on is it's like we just quickly, or I can speak for myself, I can quickly tip into that sense of hopelessness and sense of despair. And I think that, I think we just have to kind of find our way to come a little bit more to the middle with that. You know, it's, And I think that we can do that by really developing more resilience for ourselves, for others, for those we love. And so I don't, this is kind of a practical piece, but I thought I will just kind of throw that out in talking about reliance that I worked with. So I also worked with Kathy with the Denver Hospice for so many years. And hospice was a phenomenal teacher for me throughout my life. And there was one amazing doctor that came to speak to us that actually spoke about resilience. And what her feeling was that it's like for us to do the hard work, whatever hard work is, and I think right now we have lots of hard work to do, but it's like to do the hard work, we have to be resilient. And so she talked about, I think there's like, seven of them, but she identified what she considered to be building blocks for resilience, and she says we just need to kind of build on all of these things individually in order to be as resilient as we possibly can. And some of them, I mean, none of this will be new to you, but her building blocks were physical health. You know, we need to build physical health. And I kind of feel like as I'm getting older, it's like for me to tend to my physical health could be a full-time job, but it's like it's just one building block. So our physical health is so important for resilience, our emotional health, and really tending to, just taking care of ourselves emotionally, spiritually. Our relationships are a part of that. She talked about having a healthy mindset or worldview. And the hopeful piece of that is that, you know, all of our, you know, our mindset, we can change that when we have awareness around that. The importance of values and beliefs, having purpose and meaning in life, all of those things are really important in building resilience. And so like I said earlier, I think change and stress is really a threat to our equilibrium. And so by developing resilience, ability to cope, both within ourselves, but then within our communities, I think that is one direction, one way of finding our way right now in all of these difficult times. So in concluding, you know, I think much of what underlies our anger, our rage, possibly what underlies violence, I think all of that is grief. Grief and just the experience of loss. And I just feel like, and I think we do need to really talk about it and have it be out in the open in terms of the grief of what's going on. It's not just all these individual issues that are driving us all crazy and hurting us, but it's like there's grief behind that. And sometimes I feel like we've gotten better as a culture, and sometimes I feel maybe not so much. But anyway, we don't have much space in our culture for grief. And so what I want to say about that is that I think that when grief is unaddressed, I think it becomes grievance. And so, when we're living in a culture with so much grievance, I think grievances lead us to blame and pointing fingers. And I think it's in response to our inability to really feel grief for what grief is, the sadness around that. I just want to say that it's like we can't, or at least I don't feel like we can do this alone. And I think that we need to have our communities around us and one another. It's always been important, but even probably more important. And I think it's a time that we really need to be courageous. You know, we need to commit to love, kindness, caring for ourselves, for others, for our communities, for our world. And so I thought today I would end with a little reading. So one of my favorite people is John O'Donohue. And he did a blessing for courage, because I guess that's what I would like to leave everyone with, is that I think that this is a time when we need to be courageous and help one another be courageous. So this is a blessing for courage. When the light around you lessens, and your thoughts darken until your body feels fear turn cold as a stone inside. When you find yourself bereft of any belief in yourself and all your unknowingly learned on has fallen. When one voice commands your whole heart and it is raven dark, steady yourself and see that it is your own thinking that darkens your world. Search and you will find a diamond thought of light. Know that you are not alone and that this darkness has purpose. Gradually, it will school your eyes to find the one gift your life requires hidden within this night corner. Evoke the learning of every suffering you have suffered. Close your eyes, gather all the kindling around your heart to create one spark. That is all you need to nourish the flame that will cleanse the dark of its weight of festered fear. A new confidence will come alive to urge you towards higher ground where your imagination will learn to engage difficulty as its more rewarding threshold.
And now, if you're able, please stand with us and sing our song of reflection, ground and source of all that is.
Would you join me in our prayer of thanksgiving? Good and generous God, receive these gifts as an offering of our love and lives. May they be used to benefit your people and serve the greater good. Amen. Now, if you want to stand, we're going to sing our closing song. We will not keep from singing.
And we'll keep us singing.
join me in the benediction. Go in the freedom of new life in Christ. Go in the liberty that transcends the way of the world. Go in the hope, power, and peace of the good news. Amen. Peace be with you. To those of you online, peace be with you as well. May we share together in passing the peace.